Welcome to the EPG Pathshala. I am Professor Rekha Pandey from the Department of History in the University of Hyderabad. The module that I am going to take up now is Emergence of Women's Organizations. This is part of paper 3 of Women's Studies titled Women and History. And we are now going to talk about the development and the emergence of various women's organizations that came up. When we look back into the history, and especially when we are talking of women's history, we find that in ancient period, or that's applicable to the medieval period also, women were largely connected to the family. And most of the women whom they met were primarily through family, when there was a family function, maybe when there was a marriage in the family or when there was death in the family. And so women really did not meet anyone outside their family. But however, with the educational experiments of the late 19th and early 20th century, we find that a new women emerged in the horizons, and the interest of this women moved beyond the household. Now, for the first time in the history of our country, we find that women began to communicate with women who were outside their families, outside their local communities. On the one hand, we had a small group of women who shared their knowledge of English as a common language. And therefore, this made it possible for these women to cut across the language barrier. They could communicate with other women in the same language. And as a result of this, we find that there developed various women's organizations from 19th century onwards. And therefore, I'm going to give you some information on these organizations. We can divide these organizations into three phases. The first phase was in the period 1850 to 1915. The second phase was in the period 1915 to 1947. And the third phase comes after India becomes independent, from 1947 to the present day. The third phase in the post-independence period can be divided again into three more phases. The first one I would refer to as the period of accommodation. That is from 1947 to late 1960s. The second would be the period of crisis, from late 60s to about 75. And the third would be between 1975 to the present date. Now, the first phase of the formations of these organizations can be referred to as the reformist phase. Now, this was a period where, feminism in India was primarily initiated by the men, primarily to uproot certain social evils of our society, such as sati, widow immolation, forbidding of widow remarriages, which was taking up issues of child marriage, illiteracy, as well as regulation of the age of consent and property rights through legal interventions. Now, women in this phase were primarily categorized along with the lower caste as subjects of social reform and welfare. And women were not recognized as agents of social change. It was not recognized that women could be an autonomous group. And by and large, even the women who were involved were those who were related to these male activists. Many of them were very elitist, they had Western education, and most of them came from upper caste Hindu society. Ishwarchand Vidyasagar's crusades for improvement in the condition of widows led to the Widow Remarriage Act of 1956. And there were a large number of women who helped and for the cause of women's upliftment. And these women were women like Pandita Ramabai, and they were also very much involved in women's social reforms. In this phase, You know, initially you had social reformers like Mahadev Govind Ranade. He founded the Widow Remarriage Association and the Deccan Education Society. And they were attempting to bring in education for women. But however, we find that soon women took over the reins in the battle for their own independence. And it was Pandita Ramabai, who is considered the first Indian feminist, who addressed the other women directly, and she spoke about, you know, emancipation of Indian women. You also, you know, Pandita Ramabai was born in 1858 in Western Maharashtra. Her father, Anand Shastri, was a learned Brahmin and a social reformer. He used to give a lot of lectures on the need of female education. And so, you know, when Ramabai used to accompany him, she also, you know, listened to these lectures. And after the death of her father, she decided to carry further his work. And she continued this tradition of going and talking about women's education. And she earned a lot of fame by giving these lectures to different societies. In fact, the pundits of Calcutta were so astounded by her clearness of views and eloquence in presenting them that they conferred on her the highest title of Saraswati, the goddess of wisdom. She also started a school for child widows in 1882 in Bombay, and she is the one who started the organization called Arya Mahila Samaj. And she also took initiative because she could see the condition of the widows, and in 1889 she started the first home for widows in Maharashtra called the Sharda Sadan. Now during this period we find that you know, the struggle against colonial rule intensified, and nationalism became the preeminent cause. The Indian National Congress, led by Gandhiji, was one of the first political organizations that actively included women, even women who were formerly in the parda. In fact, Gandhi is hailed as the parent of the women's movement because he really brought in feminization of politics. Now, although many of these women were mobilized from different parts of the country in the name of nationalism, and there was a lot of extensive political activity, and this became a kind of catalyst for the development of a future self-consciousness of feminism in India. And in 1917, the Congress demanded that the women should also be able to vote on the same basis as men. But these efforts were for the progress of nationalism rather than exclusively for the improvement of women's rights. So, you know, there were certain limitations in this. However, Gandhi played a major role because he legitimized and expanded Indian women's public activities, and he involved them to a large extent in his non-violent civil disobedience movement against the Raj. And in the decades that followed, we find that women not only actively participated in the freedom movement, but they also started forming their own organizations, which were basically focusing for the improvement of the lot of the women of those times. There were a large number of these organizations. Sarla Devi started the Bharat Stri Mahamandal. In this organization met for the first time in Allahabad in 1910, and we soon find that it was able to establish its branches in different parts of the country, such as Delhi, Lahore, Karachi, Amritsar, Hyderabad. And these organizations addressed a large number of issues. Some of these problems included parda, which to them was a stumbling block to accept female education. Since most of the women were getting married early, they were withdrawn from education, many of the women were in parda, so they would not follow education. So many of these organizations started talking about the issue of parda so that more and more women could come into the public arena and join education. They widened their issues over teaching the English. They also spoke of hygiene. In fact, they started sending teachers to the home of many of the girls in order to teach them reading and writing, music, sewing and embroidery. Because there was a hesitancy on the part of many families to send their girls into the public arena. And there were three major organizations that came up at this time. One was the Women's India Association, which is referred to as WIA. And the second was the National Council of Women in India, NCWI. And the third was the All India Women's Conference, that is the AIWC. And all these three organizations were formed in the period between 1917 to 1927, after the first, when the First World War was almost close. And the Women's India Association, it had its roots also got a support from a large number of feminists outside the country. Now, Margaret Cousin and some of the Irish feminists met many women in the Theosophical Society in Adyar in 1915. And they then got together, they discussed, and the first Women's India Association was formulated, and its primary goal was to encourage female education. They developed a kind of network. They got a lot of support from each other. They organized weekly lectures for these newly educated women, so that they could meet each other, they could make friends outside, and they could also widen their knowledge of different issues. And they also brought out a monthly journal called Stri Dharma, and it was published in English, but it did have articles in Hindi and Tamil. Soon, this organization also developed its branches, and by the end of the year, it had about 33 branches. One thing very interesting about this organization was that it opened its membership to both Indians and Europeans, and it represented women from different races, religion, and cultures, because it felt that some of the issues that whether the women in India or outside were talking was something which was concerned with all women. And we find that this monthly journal brought out by them called Stri Dharma, it carried news of a lot of interest for women. And there were articles which were published in regional language so that women who did not know English could also read these articles in Hindi and Tamil. It was not that easy and smooth sailing for these organizations. They found a lot of difficulties in finding local branches, and there was a lot of competition between these organizations, who were seeking women's attention, along with the self-respect movement, which was also fighting for the rights of the women. And the lacuna in this organization was that by and large it was only limited to a very elite upper caste women, because English became a medium through which they were exchanging their views. And one of the members said it is a bull's work to drag out our reluctant sisters from the kitchen and persuade them to spend few minutes at our meetings periodically. See, right from the beginning till about 19th century, women were living in a mindset where their whole world was within the private realm of the house, within the family, in the kitchen. So it was very difficult for them to come out and just join a meeting, which in the mind of many women served no purpose. But then this movement had a large agenda for women's rights, and they pursued it without any fail. The next very important organization was the International Council for Women. It was first convened in Washington, D.C. in 1888. and they wanted to establish their branches in India. So as a result of the meeting of the International Council for Women, the National Council for Women of India was established. And we find that Meherbhai Tata became the chair of the Bombay Council, and she played a major role in this organization. She had married the elder son of Jamshedji Tata, and therefore, you know, she belonged to a very important and influential industrial family of India. To her, you know, her caste and the parda, and it was the lack of education that prevented women from coming out into the open. And therefore, she really worked towards trying to change the social condition so that women come out of the parda and they move in forward towards gaining education. You had a large number of women who joined this organization. You had women like Margaret Cousin, who always gave her support. You had Dorothy Jamshed, Ginger Dasa, Annie Besant, Ambuja Mal, Malti Patwardhan, Kanuben Mehta. And some of the areas where this organization worked was, it was focusing on religion, education, politics. It also got involved in a large number of philanthropic work. In fact, they organized a number of adult classes related to sewing, crafts, because they felt more and more women would come in if they would teach these skills. And then they slowly started focusing on first aid, on literacy. And so, you know, they were trying to widen their expanse and bring in more and more women to the organization. Now, we find by 1925, you had the National Council of Women in India had set up its branches not only in Bombay but also in Calcutta and Madras, and it utilized a large number of the networks that were developed during the World War. You know, a lot of work was carried out through these networks, through various clubs and association, and they were trying to help during the war. And these networks were used by the National Council of Women in India so that they could establish new councils and help in the cause of women. The other international association was, you know, the Marchioness of Aberdeen, who was the president of the International Council of Women from 1922 to 1936. She learned about this International Council and she invited a large number of members to join this. In fact, in 1925, the NCWI was, it became a national branch, and it was very well established at this time. And as I already mentioned, Meherbhai Tata played a very key role. She could not only enlist the support of large number of elite women for this organization, but she could also draw in a large number of men who supported female education, who were talking of freedom for the women at this time. But there were certain restrictions in this, it had its own limitation, because by and large, this was a very elitist organization, and that's the reason it did not really become an All India national organization. Among its members, it really included some very elite women like the Dowager Sahib of Bhopal, Maharani Sahib of Baroda, Lady Dorabji Tata, and Maharani Setu Parvati Bai of Travancore. So, you know, you had all the women from the royal families who were involved. And it could never become an All India organization. And it was primarily the All India Women's Congress, which was formed later on, that really had a pan-India kind of presence. And it was founded, the All India Women's Congress was founded in 1927. It started with a very modest objective of trying to improve women's education. And it was, you know, among all the other two organizations that I mentioned, this organization was most Indian. and it could really expand its scope of activity. It had a large number of members and people could really identify with this organization. It met in Pune in 1927, and this was followed by more than 6 months of work, serious work by Margaret Cousins and a large number of other women. By 1929, it also, you know, just moving away from women's education, it spoke of a large number of reforms for the upliftment of women, and it enlarged its scope of social reform. Some of the eminent women who were part of the AIWC included a large number of social reformers of India, and Sarojini Naidu also played a major role. Margaret Cousins was definitely involved. You had Annie Besant, Vijayalakshmi Pandit, you know, and they really played a major role in the All India Women's Congress, and they agreed that their whole role was they were producing educated wives, mothers. They were also talking of having educated women doctors, professors, lawyers, and they strongly believed that in ancient India, women had equal access to education. Women were very wealthy. Women also had political power. And they believe that many of the evils that had come into Indian society, you know, some of the social customs such as child marriage and parda, which was an impediment for women's emancipation, this came about primarily as a result of foreign invasion. And because of this, you know, child marriage and parda, many women were not going in for education. So, you know, they had a very clear picture of Indian society, saying that ancient period women were very advanced, they were very developed, they had education, they had power, they had wealth. And it was primarily when the foreign invasions took place during the medieval period that you had problems like child marriage and parda which came in, and therefore women were not being educated at this time. They interpreted history along the same lines like how the Orientalists were talking. They spoke of the past greatness of ancient India followed by a very dark age. They, they legitimized the organization and the thrust of its program by speaking of a very, golden age in the past, followed by a dark age. And now, you know, they are trying to talk about another, upliftment and a golden age. Many of the subcommittees of this organization included labor, rural reconstruction, opium. They were also talking about the Sharda Act. They also spoke of film censorship. And there was a lot of discussion on birth control. You know, at least first time they were talking about issues which no one else was talking about. And it also included a number of women from the WIA and NCWIA, the earlier organization. So, you know, it could get a large number of, members for its organization. Some of the actions of the All India Women's Congress included that they played a major role in bringing in the Sharda Act of 1929. Where child marriage was forbidden. It also played a major role in the dissolution of the Muslim Marriage Act of 1939. It also had various acts and bills passed so that, you know, there is better supervision of orphanages, widow rescue homes and marriage bureaus. In fact, in 1946, it also first time set up a central office with a permanent staff. And over a period of time, many of the issues on which they were fighting became more focused. Education continued to be a major area where many of them were fighting for. They also spoke of legal reform. They also started addressing the question of violence against women. They also spoke of women's human rights. And they were also talking of environment conservation and preservation. You know, this was something which was very new. In fact, the All India Women's Congress continues to be of, you know, an organization which is there. And it could get more than 1 lakh members. It had about 500 branches across the country. And it became one of the premier organizations at that time working for women's development and empowerment. Besides this, you know, we also had some other, you know, different kinds of local organizations which sprang up throughout the country. And a very important organization among them was the Desh Sevika Sangh, the National Women's Volunteer Organization. It was set up in 1930, and its primary aim was to get self-rule for women. It was talking of, you know, in the country when they were talking of self-rule, self-government, this organization spoke of self-rule for women. And its focus was, like, you know, the political parties at that time were doing. It spoke of banning foreign cloth. It also spoke about eradicating drinking of liquor. It focused a lot on the production of khadar, so that, you know, more and more women start using khadar. It took a very active part in the civil disobedience movement, and the British government declared it an illegal organization because they were so much politically involved with these issues. And then, you know, you also had the West Bengal Women's Union. This was an organization which started in 1932. It was primarily from the women in West Bengal. They formed a cadre of like-minded women so that, you know, they could help the helpless, exploited and victimized fellow women. You know, it was focusing on women. Some of the issues that it spoke of was like suppression of immoral trafficking in Bengal. It also formed the Bengal Presidency Council for Women and the All Bengal Women's Conference. So they were also very actively involved. In fact, they also worked to a large extent on the issue of trafficking of women and children. And they felt that, you know, this was an area that was becoming very large. More and more children and women were getting into trafficking, but nobody was addressing this problem. So they started talking about this, and it soon, you know, they formed an organization called All Bengal's Women's Union, ABWU. And it became soon affiliated to the International Abolitionist Federation of Geneva. You know, some of the women who played a very major role in some of these organizations, I will discuss about some of these women. Durgabai Deshmukh from, you know, Andhra Pradesh became very actively involved in the women's issue. And she formed an organization called Andhra Mahila Sabha. Durgabai Deshmukh was born in a middle class family in Kakinada in Andhra Pradesh, and in fact she started participating in the nationalist movement from the age of 12, and even today, you know, she is regarded as a mother of the social service in India. And it was to her credit that she founded the Andhra Mahila Sabha in 1937. Even today in Hyderabad and many parts of Andhra, you see that the Andhra Mahila Sabha runs a large number of colleges, high schools. It also has a large number of hospitals that work under its banner. Durgabai Deshmukh was, you know, very much involved with a lot of issues which affected women. She spoke against illiteracy, ignorance, and she kept on talking about the social injustice done to women. And she was able to establish a number of institutions related to healthcare, to nutrition, to education. In fact, she became a member of the parliament, and as you know, after independence, as a member of this, you know, social welfare board, 1953. She carried out many of the works of this organization, which was formed before India became independent. And she continued to have a large number of programs for educating, training, and rehabilitating women and children and the disabled. She was the recipient of the Paul G. Hoffman Award. She also got the Padma Vibhushan. She got the UNESCO Award for outstanding work in field of literacy. So, you know, she was recognized for her work and the amount of focus she had on these social issues. Now, when we come back to the post-independence period, till now I was talking about organizations which had come into being before India became independent. And as I mentioned earlier, we can divide the organizations chronologically after India became independent into three phases. The first is the period of accommodation from 1947 to late 60s. The second is the period of crisis from 60s to about 75. And the third phase is of the organizations that come in from 1975 to date. Now, most of the organization in the first phase, you know, this was a continuation of many of the organizations that were set up in the pre-independence period. And they spoke about issues of, you know, they were talking about adoption of constitution and legal reforms. They also spoke of development planning and they encouraged a mixed economy. They gave a lot of support to social welfare activities. So they were working to a large extent. In fact, many of the women who were involved with these women's organizations were also actively involved in the freedom struggle. And therefore, you know, their whole involvement in the freedom struggle helped them develop a critical consciousness about what would their roles be, what would their rights be in an independent India. And it was, you know, see, if we look back into the history of this period, though, you know, women's issues became very important in the pre-independence period, but many of these organizations joined hands with the nationalist movement because it was believed that, you know, first India has to be independent and unless we become independent and then we can take up these issues. So many of these organizations gave a lot of support to the nationalist movement. They joined the freedom struggle. But then, you know, when India became independent, many of these continued, and it was primarily because of the efforts of these organizations that there was introduction of franchise, civil rights for women in the Indian Constitution. The state adapted a kind of a very patronizing role towards women. In fact, you know, we got the right of vote. It didn't really require, though there was of course some kind of a struggle, at least in the pre-independence period, to get the right to vote. But we did not have to struggle for this for a long period, unlike the women in the West. So there were, you know, various acts which were passed during this phase. You had the Marriage Act of 1954, the Hindu Code Bill of 1955-56. They were talking about issues of marriage, divorce, succession, guardianship, adoption, a number of these issues. And monogamy was made legal according to the Hindu Marriage Act. It outlawed polygamy among the Hindus because these were some of the issues which affected women much more than the men. And it conferred this equal right of divorce on both men and women. It also made intercaste and interreligious marriage legal. It fixed the marriage age for both boys and girls. And it made child marriage punishable. It also, you know, you had various other kinds of acts that were passed at this time. You had the Hindu Succession Act in 1956, the Hindu Minority and Guardianship Act of 1956, the Dowry Prohibition Act of 61, the Maternity Benefit Act of 1961. And, you know, I'm not saying that men were not, there were a large number of men, but also equal number of women who were involved, who came from these organizations and who supported these acts and took it forward. The National Federation of Indian Women, NFIW, was the women's wing of the Communist Party. It was established in 1954, and amongst its leaders, it included Aruna Asaf Ali. They also work to a large extent for the empowerment of women and women's rights. Then you also had the National Federation of Indian Women, NFIW, which was affiliated to the Women's International Democratic Federation. You also had the WIDF, which primarily composed of women who belong to socialist countries. You know, so the women's organization were also expanding their reach outside India. Now, if you look at the second phase, that is the period from 60s to 75. In the first phase, they carried out various reforms in our society which would benefit women, and many of these acts and bills were passed. But in the second phase, we find that India went through a period of crisis. There was an economic crisis and there was stagnation from the period of 60s. The prices were increasing, there was increasing landlessness, and there was a lot of discontent in both the rural and urban areas during this time. So, you know, the Green Revolution of 1967 and 78, it dramatically improved the agricultural techniques, and there was an increase in agricultural production, and it was very successful in India. And though food was available in plenty, we find that many of the farmers were not wealthy enough to keep up with technology, and so they got left over in this whole period. And you had a number of women farmers who were very much at the bottom of the poverty. And therefore, you had some other significant movements that emerged. In 1971, you had the CPI Marxists, which set up the Shramik Mahila Sangathan, the working women's organization. It was trying to mobilize women from lower, middle and working class. It was affected by the growing economic crisis and economic hardship. Then, the 73s also saw an anti-price rise movement. This was a united front composed of women from all CPI Marxists, Socialists, Congress, and you had a large number of women who did not belong to any political party participate in this. You had middle class women, housewives from urban areas in Western India, because price rise was something which was affecting all women, and they participated in this in a large way. You had other organizations like the Progressive Organization of Women, POW. It was founded in 1974. And the popular base of this movement was the rural women, who were working in the field. And it was in this year that the Official Status of Women Commission published their report towards equality. And it showed that, women's status was very low. It was ever decreasing in Indian society. And therefore, even the Progressive Organization of Women took up a large number of issues related to women. It spoke on issues like it participated to a large extent in anti-dowry campaigns. It protested against eve teasing, harassment of women, street obscenity, price rise. It also spoke against the hardship suffered by women living in slums. And this was immediately followed by emergency. Now, in the period of emergency, there was a lot of repression, and many of these organizations disintegrated. Some of them disintegrated within 1 or 2 years of their formation. And we find that there were, a large number of autonomous groups that came up at this time. You had a large number of organizations. They were focusing on issues of housework, party politics. Some of them spoke of dowry, deaths, rapes. The issue of violence, popularly called atrocities against women, this became the centerpiece of the movement, especially from the early 80s. And now, slowly we can see that the women's organization is expanding and the women's movement also expanded. Another very important organization about which I should talk is the SEWA, the Self-Employed Women's Association. It was a trade union which was founded in 1972 after the split in the Textile Labour Association. And the founder of this was the civil rights leader, Dr. Ila Bhatt. Her goal was to provide full employment and self-reliance for women. And Seva received the Right of Livelihood Award in 1984. So it did immense services. Now, if you look at the third phase, you know, from 1975 to the present day, now we find, you know, it will be very difficult for me to give you the names of the organizations because you have so many of them. But then, you know, what is very important is you had a large number of autonomous groups who popped up during this period. They had different agenda, they were fighting on different issues. Some of the major issues, all of them were focusing around women's issues. They were talk of housework, party politics, they were focusing on violence, trafficking, dowry, death, rape. And it was, violence became a very important issue, and many of these organizations came together on this issue. Now, if you look at the period from the 80s, we find that there has been an increase, you know, day by day the number of women's organization is increasing, and there are more than hundreds of these organization, and we also have the National Commission of Women, which was established in New Delhi, which takes up many of these issues. You also have the National Council of Women in Pune, the Joint Women's Program in Delhi. Then there was Kali for Women. There are so many of these NGOs that came up. And it was in 1992, 31st January, that the National Commission of Women was set up according to the Act of National Commission for Women Act of 1990. And this commission is, you know, it hears a lot of complaints related to women. When the rights of women are refused, it also looks into issues of cruelty and other atrocities, and it tries to redress the grievances of women. And then you also have the Rashtriya Mahila Kosh, the National Credit Fund for Women. It was formed on 30th March 1993. Then you had, you know, many of the poor and needy women are organized throughout the country under various self-help groups. You know, these groups come together to either start a small industry, a small occupation, and they are provided financial fund. This has empowered women at the grassroots to a large extent. Then you also have a number of programs that have come up, the Balika Samriddhi Yojana in 1997, the female children, you know, who are born to poor mothers below poverty line, they are helped under this program. Then you also have the Swa Shakti project, which was started in 1998. And women, it gives some kind of a financial assistance, you know, to these women who want to start productive work. And government plays a major role in distributing these finances. And then you, you know, if you look at it right, there have been a lot of efforts by the government, by the non-government organization, and all of these are aimed towards the development of women. And all these organizations speak about the improvement of women's position in India, and it talks a lot about the you know, progress of a country can only be achieved once women are emancipated. So all of them are working towards the emancipation of women. Therefore, you know, we looked at the various organizations that were formed, and I would like to now sum up saying that if you look at the past in ancient and medieval India, the women had no other opportunities to interact with other women. They were only interacting with family members. But once when education comes in, you had the growth of these various women's organizations. And then, you know, initially it was the men who took a lead, but then women also started joining in. And then you had a large proliferation of these organizations, you know, in the pre-independence period, and it continues after the independence till present day, and you have these large number of women's organizations that are focusing on women's issues. Thank you.